I can't see anything, so if it really sucks, make some like negative noise, okay? Nice. I love you, man. All right, so how many of you have heard my intro? Show of hands. That sucks, I can't see you. All right, well, somebody told me that my intro was way too long and that I had to shorten it. And specifically that I had to shorten it to 60 seconds. So here I go. Hi, my name is, and I do this. I work for this company, and I do this for them. I'm also a devoted one of these, which some people think is this, and some people think is this. But whatever you think it is, I'm not one of these, unless, of course, you think I'm this kind. I'm also a professional one of these, although I'm not dead yet. I'm more like one of these, although I look nothing like Kevin Mitnick, which this guy looks like. But I must be one of these, because whenever I see something like this, my browser auto-fills in something like this. I'm also one of these, for these nice folks, as evidenced by all of this. This guy's cool, so I'm a student of this, which kind of translates into this, which kind of translates into this. I just passed my test for this, which is really close to this. Which I think is a very nice color. I'm also one of these, although not the Lego kind, so more like this, although not the dead kind, so I'm more like this, but without the, Yeah, I don't have boots, I have sandals, see? I'm also a blood descendant of this guy. It's a really crappy picture. He looks cooler like this, which most of you know by the bottle he carries around. See the guy? He's behind the bottle. So this is me, which is a lot to say, so since I lack certifications, I figure I can make something out of this, something like maybe this, which can benefit from a few more letters like one of these and maybe one of these, which shortens into this. So that's my business card. All right. Now let me, as most of you know, I do a little serious bit before we start to have some fun. So let me tell you a little bit about what's been happening in the past like 6 months for me. For the past couple of years, I've been supporting a group called Invisible Children, which most of you might know. You've heard me talk about it before. The idea behind Invisible Children was they were helping out refugees in northern Uganda, child soldiers. Instead of sending money, which I might add, the hacker community raised several hundred dollars for the cause just by buying books, I decided it was time to actually go to Uganda and see what this was all about to try to do some work. So I sent out an email to a few trusted friends, and it apparently got blogged. And what ended up happening was the hacker community, along with a couple sponsors like Hacker Foundation, Singer's Publishing, SensePost, fully funded a missions trip for me and my wife to go to Uganda to do IT work. Let me repeat that. The hacker community fully sponsored the trip, paid for everything. So I figured if the hacker community could do that, what's next? And this is what's next. I swear I'm going to get bumper stickers for this. The idea behind iHackCharities.org is to connect the skills of the hacker community with charities that have technical needs, because most charities can't afford the skills in this room, right? So the idea is pretty simple. We set up projects that involve micro projects from like 2 to 8 hours in length. We solicit the hacker community for help completing those projects. In exchange for professional references from industry leaders, you get a professional reference from somebody like me, which you can put on your resume. You also get a validation from that organization that says you did the work. You also get a LinkedIn connection through somebody like me. The bottom line is you do 5 or 6 micro projects, you don't get paid, but you get a killer resume. So whether or not you care about helping charity or not, if you're sick of flipping burgers and want to use your skills to get a real job, this might be for you. So check it out. All right, and on with the show. This is high tech, this kind of stuff, this wireless stuff, and these viruses, and these worms, and these Trojans. And passwords, and biometrics, and lock picking, and packet sniffing, and all this stuff. This is high tech. I'm not here to talk about high tech, I'm here to talk about no tech. So I did a chapter in this book called No Tech Hacking, which is actually gonna turn into a full-blown book. You can download a sample chapter off my website. And it talks about this guy I used to work with named Vince. Let me tell you a little bit about Vince. I was a pen tester, so I knew all about this network stuff. Vince was a physical security expert. He broke into buildings, which I knew nothing about. But Vince was like sort of creepy. Is Vince here? Did anybody raise their hand? I can't tell. All right, anyway. So Vince was a little creepy because he had this like strange ability to break into places like just by sneezing and stuff. It was really strange. So I go on this gig with Vince and we have to get into the secured building and they've got like this skiff door that looks like the door to a castle. Looks like you could drive like a Mack truck into it at 50 miles an hour and it would bounce. And it's like the only way into this building and they got a little Prox card reader there. So I'm watching Vince and he's watching people come out of this building. He's just watching them come out, watching them. And I'm like, this is gonna be cool. I'm thinking like, he's gonna bring out some like RFID duplicator thingamabob. You know, he heard about major malfunction stuff and you know, all that stuff, and he's gonna go nuts. And he says, we gotta go. I'm like, what do you mean we gotta go? He's like, we gotta go back to the hotel. So thinking Vince had some sort of bowel disorder, I went with him. He came out of the hotel with a wire coat hanger and a wet washcloth. So at this point, I think he's got some sort of bowel disorder. Some sort of rather messy bowel disorder. We get to the site. He walks up to the door. It's like 6:30. It's after business hours. And he walks up to the door, puts the washcloth on the end of the coat hanger, slips it through the middle of the door and starts flapping it around right between the seams. I hear this ka-chunk. The door opens, pulls it open, and walks in. And I'm still standing there. So like a second later, the door opens again. He's like, you coming? So what Vince had noticed from watching the people come out of the building was that there was this bar on the back of the door that let him get out, right? It's not a push bar. It's like touch sensitive. Right, it's easier to help people get out of the building when it's on fire and all that. The problem was the multi-million dollar security system didn't know the difference between a human hand and a wet washcloth. So for no money and hardly any materials, he took down the whole system. And at that point, I learned a valuable lesson. And the valuable lesson was, don't make things difficult for yourself, right? Whether you're a bad guy, which you're not gonna get any ideas from me, or at least admit that you didn't get them from me, please. Or a good guy doing an assessment, don't make things difficult for you. This is the art of no-tech hacking. So I'm gonna start you with a little bit of a warm-up. What does a hacker see? Don't be shy. Why do you think it's a cop? It's undercover. Yeah, I'm hearing lots of good reasons. You know, they take the undercover cop cars and put this on it, so that you don't know they're undercover cop cars. All right, what about this? Fed. Yes, at ShmooCon, somebody said, this is the man with the candy. All right, now here's a trickier one. Let's assume for a second this car is parked at this person's business. This is where they work. How would you tell me where they live? Possibly. Think no tech. I heard sticker. Somebody said sticker. How about this? Right, the little oil change sticker lists most of the time the address where you get your oil changed. If it doesn't match the address of where you are, what does it mean? Could be. All right, you get the idea. Look at this parking lot. What does a hacker see? Opportunity. No, that's just a criminal. That's a little different. All right, well, I'll give you a break on that one. Let's go really hard on this one. Tell me how much this person makes per year, up to the penny. Yeah, you're guessing. All right, well, let me give you another clue. Yeah, you see where this is going, don't you? All right, let's try the parking lot again. What does a hacker see? Somebody in the front row says military sticker. Fed. That's right. Military District of Washington. Now, let me get this straight. The post 9/11 Department of Defense allows stickers on the windshield to identify all DOD employees and contractors. Is that right? I'm just checking. All right. Well, part of no-tech hacking is also this thing called social engineering and information gathering. You want to see how it works? Okay. Can anybody tell me what the colors of these stickers mean? What's black? This guy says contractor. All right, what's blue? Officer. See, this is information gathering. Let me see if they're learning. What's red? My job here is done. All right, so there's lots of these things from lots of different places. I have a really nice collection of them, and I'm really irritating when I drive because I'm like constantly like getting pictures of these things and turning around. Some are more interesting than others. This one's nice. This I thought was Huachuca. I was told it wasn't. But I love the acronyms the government uses. Anybody know what that means? Somebody said Indian Head Division Naval Surface Warfare Center, didn't they? I heard them. Bad Fed. All right. Well, let's just say for a minute you weren't a Fed and didn't know what this meant. Where would you go to find out? Not Yahoo, right? That's right. There it is. Google is your friend. All right, let's go a little easier. Tell me what this person does for a living. Yep. All right, tell me about this person's social status. All right, tell me whether or not they're a real geek. Stephen King's The Cell. I'll let you pass your own judgment on that one. Okay, so this picture was really hard to get because this particular vehicle was going easily 180 miles per hour. And it's a red Saturn. So I'm like, okay, a red Saturn is defeating the laws of physics. And it had a funny looking license plate, so I had to catch it. When I finally caught up with this car, also breaking the laws of physics with my car, I saw this. Suddenly I was glad I could keep up. All right, now, for this one, tell me what this person, the person who drives this car, tell me what they are. Not what they do, not where they live. What are they? Old. Possibly. Try again. All right. No Mac insults, please. All right. You guys still don't get this. You're obviously, you're not good at this. Student? Okay. No. All right, let me give you another clue, because obviously you aren't trained in the arts. The driver of this car is a ninja. No, it's not mine. All right, so tell me about the person that drives this car. Here, I'll help. Yeah. Okay, so does anybody else know anything about Navy Chiefs? Well, I've never been in the military, but I know a few things about Navy Chiefs. Here's Hollywood's depiction of a Navy Chief from Men of Honor. All right. Here is the Navy Chief who's currently handcuffed after headbutting one of his captors. That's him in the background, unconscious. And this is what he's done to the other guy. He's pretty much done all of this with his face. So I know a little bit about Navy Chiefs. What else can you tell me about this particular Navy Chief? Yes. So basically what we have is a Navy Chief that's into guns. So I can't hold back. I have to show you the video footage of the horror I witnessed in this car. You ready? This is not for the weak of heart. I told you, man, it's scary. Whew. All right, let's try this again. Guy in the black shirt. What does a hacker see? Why military? I heard military. The haircut, good. The boots, what kind of boots? No tech, yeah. Yeah. Shine shoes, yeah, okay. Let's get a little bit closer. Tell me a little bit more. Oakleys, what kind of Oakleys? There's a nickname for this type of Oakley. Shooters? Oakley shooters? People that wear Oakley shooters do what? Yeah, okay, and the back of his hat, can you read it? It says BenelliUSA.com. Any idea? Yeah, okay, they don't just make like the hunting kind. These are like armor-piercing shotguns here, folks. All right, so we know a little bit about this guy. But what would you say if I told you that I got this guy's picture in an airport, he was on my flight, and he boarded with the people who needed special assistance? By himself. Yeah, well, I think he's worse than that. I think he's the undercover air marshal. Scary. All right, what can you tell me about this guy? He wears the pens, that's good. So we have an obvious vitamin E deficiency. All right, what sorts of things could we use to figure out what this guy does for a living? Yep, the magazine, and maybe the bag. Can anybody read the logo? U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission. I don't think he got it from their con because their con sucks. And here's his Sky Miles tag. Now, in these pictures, you can see, you know, see the little blur there on the side of the screen? A little bit there. That's my arm and my side because I'm taking the picture like this. Being discreet, all right? So, you know, I get pictures of my side in there and my arm in there every now and then. Well, I'm not sure, but I think eventually this guy picked up on what I was doing. And what do you think he did about it? Absolutely nothing. Yeah. That's part of the problem, isn't it? All right. So I promised you some skills. I promised you'd learn some skills, specifically blending in with the shadows, and I'd teach you the real Jedi wave. All right. Now, I want to keep my promises, so I'm gonna teach you the Jedi wave. You guys remember the Jedi wave, right? These are not the droids you're looking for, right? All right. So the Jedi wave was actually stolen from the Hacker Underground, right? It's a little motion that you make with your hand. It's like this. It's the Jedi wave. You do it when you're in trouble, all right? You do it when you're busted. You're someplace you're not supposed to be. You do the Jedi wave. 9 times out of 10, you walk away scot-free. You do the Jedi wave. The only thing is, you gotta have something in your hand when you do the Jedi wave. Like a badge. So you're in a building you're not supposed to be in. You hold up a pretty laminated piece of paper, which really is nothing. It's just a laminated piece of paper, which makes me sure that it's actually the Jedi wave you're doing more than the paper, because this always works. So this card got me into more buildings than I can count, despite the fact that AT&T doesn't make business calls to fix your phones. AT&T doesn't show up and go, "Let me into your wiring closet." But it worked for me. So these silly little pieces of paper, which you can take a picture of and duplicate and put on a cheap color printer and laminate, you know, it has really nothing, it's the wave, remember, are everywhere. These things are everywhere. Sometimes they travel alone, sometimes they travel in packs. Badges are everywhere. I could never understand why people do this, why they wear their badges around. I got these pictures from a cookout that I wasn't invited to. So I got free food and pictures of badges, but the story gets kind of worse, because this was taken around the BWI area, around certain government agencies that don't exist. Did I mention I'm not making these statements on behalf of my company and that legal action should be directed to Jeff Moss, care of Black Hat? So anyway, it turned out that the landlord decided to throw this catered barbecue, right, for all the tenants in the area, 50% of which were at a government agency. So I wandered around and started taking pictures. Site badges are one thing, but these things go an awful long way. FedEx badges, you know, be the delivery guy, get a shirt that you can't get anywhere except from the company. You could be the phone guy, you could be the gas and electric guy, you could be the DHL guy. Stupid little piece of paper, it means absolutely nothing. You know, you get the look right, you get the shirt right, you get the little piece of paper, you're golden. Well, I like these pictures because each one of these are posed. I asked these people if I could take their picture. Like, I've given up on the whole sneaking around like a ninja thing. I also found that I was getting way too many suspicious looks when I camped out in my trunk with the lid cracked open and started taking pictures. So now I just ask people for their pictures. I asked for this one, which was nice. She didn't notice that I was shooting low. You know as much as I do at this point. She has the hottest denim knees I've ever seen. So this is a nice badge because it's not only a pretty color, it's red, but this badge will let you onto the BWI airfield. Kind of, right? You can't do the Jedi wave to get onto an airfield. But if you had this badge and one of these, TSA uniform, it probably is a different story. See, but the problem is, it's not like these uniforms just go missing. Okay, all right, they might go missing, but it's not like I'm going to take a trip somewhere and one of these things is mysteriously going to show up in my suitcase. I love the headline, "No cause for concern," administration says. Uh-huh. All right, I promised you another skill, how to blend in with the feds, how to talk to them about Fed stuff and get them to listen to you, how to have a real conversation with the Fed. It's really just the Jedi trick, right? You have the badge hanging around your neck, it looks realistic. The key to this, though, is actually getting a Fed badge to wear, right? So you look the part. Well, I saw this lady at the actual cookout, sort of hanging out there, and she's talking on her BlackBerry, not paying any attention. I see all this crap on her lanyard. I'm like, I gotta get a picture of this. So I get really close, accidentally step on her foot for this one. And I see that her post-it note says, "Bring a copy of yesterday's All Hands to DSS HQ. Does anybody know what DSS is? Yeah, it's the Defense Security Service. So somehow she's working with the Defense Security Service, and she wears her badge out in public. Does anybody know what kind of badge that is? Wow, Fed. Mm-hmm. Let's try it again. Let's see if you guys are learning. Anybody know what these blue badges are? Nice. I think I have officially cleaned house with the feds in the room. Let's move along. All right. These folks, I'm not sure where exactly they work because they took their badges off, but they left their prox cards out. Well, the funny thing about prox cards is that if you get a good picture of them, you take these really complex numbers here, you punch them into a telephone, a nice person answers, and you read the numbers off the top of the card, and guess what they tell you? They tell you the address, the building, the floor, and the room that the card will work on. Clever. All right, what about the underground ninja skill that I promised? This one's probably the easiest to see through. Passing through walls in a smelly puff of smoke. It's a ninja trick. Well, actually, it's just going in the smoking entrance with the smokers. So I asked this lady, I said, can I get in the building through here? And this is a picture of her waving to me. Yeah, I followed her in a cloud of puffy smoke, walked right into the building. All right, how about another ninja skill, underground ninja skill, sucking data off of machines with your mind. All right. See, this used to be called shoulder surfing, right? But it's come so much farther than that. All right, this is shoulder surfing. This is like getting behind somebody and taking a picture of what they're working on or looking at it or whatever. I mean, I don't encourage doing this. I mean, I personally wouldn't do this because it's probably, you know, pretty rude to stand behind people and take pictures of the things that they're working on. I mean, but I should probably never do this again. All right, but I love this because I've seen cards. People put their business cards on their laptop. So now I know this guy's home address, his home telephone number, his cell phone number, his job title, where he works, the whole nine yards. But fortunately, that sort of thing doesn't happen very often. Well, okay. It happens very often, but usually the stickers are pretty small. Here's a guy working on his laptop. I got closer, closer. I think I nudged his arm on this one. Turns out he's the VP of acquisitions. And he had this little thing on the bottom of his screen, and it really made me think. The taskbar. So, Stank Dog, no, that's not his real name, it's a handle, did this paper called Electronic Deduction. I think he made a great point. So, let me talk about it here. If you're shoulder surfing somebody and you're looking at the keyboard, you're looking at the wrong spot. By looking at the screen, looking at the taskbar, you can tell an awful lot about the machine, but you can also tell an awful lot about the person that's using the machine. Let me show you how this works. What does this tell you? All right, they're on battery, it's dying. This tells you there's a lot more crap to look at. What's this? Trillion, what's its status? Very good. What's this one? What's its status? Very nice. What's this one? AIM, what's its status? Okay, let's stop there. So, this person has Trillion and AIM both installed on the machine and both active at the same time. So now tell me about this person. What kind of person might this be? Teenager, yes. Pedophile, maybe. Executive management, even better. That's good. Pointy-haired managers, good. All right, well, let's keep going. Here's another one. What's this one? MSN Messenger. Fortunately, that one's not online. All right, the volume is muted. I'll let you draw your own conclusions on that one. What about this one? Yep, that's the accelerometer thing on the ThinkPad hard drives, right, which gives you the hardware. And this thing means the machine can't be hacked. And what does this tell us? Yes, the time zone. If it doesn't match where you are, it matches where they live. Absolutely. Okay, so that's the taskbar. So we've got this like teenager or executive manager using the machine. So let me expand the taskbar and see if your opinion changes. Okay. It's Vidalia, which is running Tor. Now tell me about the person's technical ability, low, medium, or high. I would expect nothing less than a medium from a DEFCON crowd. Thank you very much. Yes, but the point is, one icon can make a whole lot of difference. If you're smart enough to look at it and figure out what this stuff means, you can deduce an awful lot from just one icon. Fortunately, we have more than just one icon to look at. If you look at somebody's browser, here's what you can figure out. If you look at someone's entire screen, God help them, because you can tell just about everything about them. What's the OS? Yeah. All right. What does this tell you? Office. Okay, you're building a profile. What's their email client? Very nice. What kind of position are they in? Very good. Tell me about additional hardware they may be carrying. A Palm. Very nice. What kind of business software do they use back at the office? SAP. And how do they connect to it? Secure Remote. VPN. All right. If you don't know what Secure Remote is, you look it up. There's your friend Google. Tells you it's Checkpoint VPN software. So you can tell a whole lot of stuff. Tell me the operating system of this Delta kiosk. Anyone? All right. Here's a tougher one. Tell me the operating system, client software, and IP addresses used by red light cameras. Ooh. All right. Good guesses. Well, I wasn't sure either, but I was driving by this light pole one day near a red light camera, and I see this. These are the technicians working on it. So I'm shooting from behind a tree. All right. Some photos here. Look at that. There's a nice little PC inside. I'm like, man, this is interesting. So I go up to the guys, and I'm like, hey, I'm a geek. Tell me what's in there. So they let me take this, and I found this to be sort of curious. Symantec PC anywhere. All right, let's move right along. Okay, tell me the operating system, IP address, gateway of this kiosk at the airport. Oh, yes, you're right. Zoom in. Okay, there. Mm-hmm. All right, tell me the bad file record segments on this particular AT&T public phone. Anyone? Oh, right, sorry. There you go. All right, tell me the technical ability of this gentleman. Low, medium, or high? How come? Yeah, he has more than one command shell open. That's a good sign, regardless of OS. All right, tell me about this guy. Tired. Mm-hmm. Did you say plumber's tan? Oh. You know, because a plumber's tan is an entirely different. And I wasn't sure how you knew that from the picture. I thought maybe, well, that's another story. Probably Marine or Army, how come? High and tight, yep. Maybe the watch. Marital status. Operating system. Email client. Rank of the person he works for. Contents of his email. Yep. And here's his boss next to him on the Crackberry. All right, what do you think this guy might do for a living? He said paintball. I don't think he goes to the DEFCON. All right, well, before I get started with this, I don't think we're going to have any luck shoulder surfing this guy because he has this. It's the Road Warrior Mobile Computing Security Best Business Practice document. Okay, they all get it. It pretty much says very clearly in the code that Road Warriors ensure against public display of content, aka shoulder surfing, that they are a wary and alert traveler. So I have no chance whatsoever with this guy. He's very wary and very alert. No. I don't think that's an iPod. I think that's like a listening device. It's like a parabolic mic. He has, it's right here. It's the Road Warrior. He's got that thing. So it's definitely not an iPod. And he's certainly not going to let me get close enough to actually lick his neck to take a picture. And yes, here he is logging into a WebLogic server as administrator. I'm pretty sure, though, this is one of his home machines, because he certainly wouldn't do that from a work machine. It's a Mac. It can be a work machine. Did anybody else notice the World of Warcraft icons down in the dock? Definitely not a work machine. All right, so I'm sitting on a plane and I see this guy. Now, he's on an aisle seat. There's an aisle across from me. There's a guy next to me and I'm in the other side of the plane, right? And I see this guy working. Guy next to me is awake. So I start taking pictures. I get my coat up here so the guy next to me doesn't get, you know, freaked out. So the guy next to me is reading a magazine. The guy two down is looking at work stuff. And then eventually I get this picture. Pretty hard to read. Government Systems USIGINT 2006 Strategic Plan. Anybody know what an USIGINT is?
I don't know.
Very nice. Very nice. This is Fed training. This is so much fun. All right, but if we didn't know, where would we go? Thank you. Electronic Warfare Signals Intelligence Strategic Plan 2006. Anybody want a copy? What's the answer?
Yes.
No. We already know there's a lot of feds in the room, people. All right. Here's another underground ninja skill. Sucking sensitive data from a corporate network from the parking lot without a wireless device. This is LEET. You guys know about LEET and LAME. This is LEET. All right. They used to call this something really lame. See if you can figure out what the attack is. Yes. We used to call this dumpster diving, but now it's sucking data off a corporate network without a wireless device. Now, this isn't just semantics. There is a big difference. You remember back in the day, what did dumpster diving mean? What did you have to do? You would dive into the dumpster, right? This is completely and utterly different. See, sucking data off a corporate network without a wireless device also means you don't break and enter into the dumpster. So you just grab the stuff that happened to already fall out. Or stick your camera inside the dumpster and take pictures while the door's open. Okay, so all this stuff I took pictures of without actually touching any garbage. Here's a service order request. Administrator printouts. Here's a Microsoft project. Here's a Watts. Anybody know what's a Watts? Very good. But Google does. A Watts is a wide area telephone service. Here's a purchase order. Here's a private line tariff surface order form. Here's a nice document with proprietary information. All right. Here is a key sales award authorization form. It lists the name of the salesperson, their title, the amount of commission they made for this contract, and their social security number. This didn't involve breaking and entering. It's actually a very easy skill. Let me show you how it works. You spot a dumpster. You make sure there's nobody in close proximity. Actually, that obviously doesn't matter because I can have my head stuck in the dumpster and nobody's going to care. And you just start taking pictures. Pictures, lots of documents. Pretty stuff. Customer confidential information. Confidential health information. Right? This is an actual healthcare provider that just decided to toss a few things in the dumpster. Does anybody know an acronym that describes what you're supposed to be following if you're a healthcare provider with regard? Thank you. Yes, and it's not HIPPO. All right. So you want to see the best thing I've ever found in the dumpster, like ever? All right. Do we have any old school dumpster divers in the audience? All right. What's like the leadest thing you ever found? Lame. I didn't hear half of that, but I can already tell you it's lame. All right, so I got to put my money where my mouth is. All right, so like a landfill is basically a big dumpster, right? So by extension, a landfill would count. So I was at the landfill one day, and I see this guy with a truck. And I'm like, gee, I wonder what he's got on that truck. I think he's done with it. And this is what it was. Yep. So, step off with your lame little credit card reports. U.S. Air Force jet in the trash, ladies and gentlemen. All right, here's another underground skill. Network sniffing without a PC and sniffing email without a PC. For less than $3. Ready? How would you do it in this room? I heard it, the TV, right there. So there's a problem with hacking TVs in hotel rooms, right? It's called the security device. So what you have to do is you have to buy this specialized tool to actually get the coax connector off, right? Or you could just jam a key down into the collar and turn the whole thing until it just pops off. Not that I'm suggesting you try that here. It's just hypothetically if you were to do something like that. All right, so once you have the coax cable off, you've actually got access to a network. Sure, you've heard talks about this. Major Malfunction does a great talk about, you know, the IR with the remote so that you can do all sorts of things to the TV. But we're talking no-tech hacking right here, less than $3. $2.99 at a thrift store. It's a cable box, right? I bypass the tuner of the TV, run it through the cable box, and change channels on the cable box, and I start to see stuff like this. And this, people watching movies and people watching, of course. All right, people checking their accounts, looking at their account information, seeing how much they've paid, seeing how much they owe, all sorts of stuff. Little $3 device, no tech hacking. Now, if you have one of these, things start to get really interesting, right? Because then you start to see screens like this, and you start to see, believe it or not, administrative consoles on the hotel network. Because it's, you know, broadband. You can fit all that stuff in there, I guess. So here's an administrative console that some admin's using. The funny thing is it's not static. I can actually see the admin using the machine. After a while, he pops up a browser, and what do you know? Start surfing porn. Not only is he surfing porn, but his browser told him that he had too many windows open. Sick. Yeah, so, you know, that little thing about, you know, the name of the movie doesn't show up on the hotel bill and it's only $13.99 a night and nobody will ever find out? Think again. All right. So you can see people logging into eBay, you can see people logging into Yahoo, forgetting their password, giving you their confirmation identity information like their birthday and their zip code. Logging into their American Express account, logging into their internet banking account. Yes, those are freaking huge numbers. This was a good one. This was at a cybercrime conference. Some guy in the Air Force starts browsing the Air Force Yahoo groups, which I'm like, man, he spends all day at a conference. He starts going to the Yahoo group. This guy's like diehard. Surfing the message groups. Sends a message off to his wife saying, feeling pretty tired. Think I'm going to go to bed. I'm like, I like this guy already. Opens up a new browser window. Does a Google search for brothel in Las Vegas and prints directions. To this. Now, technically, the guy did say he was going to bed. So he's got honesty going for him. All right, then you see stuff like this. What are you up to tonight? Me, I'm all alone in this king-size bed in my hotel room looking at your pics and stroking my ha-ha. Let's skip that one. That wasn't anybody in here, was it? Yeah, don't answer that. All right, so of these locks, pick the leadest lock. Which lock is the best? Master lock? None? Did somebody say none? All right, well, let's work on none. How do you break this one? Very good. With a pen. Here's the proof. You guys have seen it. 3, 2, 1. 3 seconds with a pen. How do you break this one? You got to think less technical. Shims are a little bit technical. Not bad, not bad. Think one-handed person with a deficiency could do it, right? Mm-hmm. the flosser, right? Seen it before, here we go. 3, 2, 1, wink. There it is. All right, how do you break this one? No, not pen. Are you making a gun? You shoot it? Oh, Mork and Mindy, right. Oh, so. No. Here you go, you ready? Can I get a shout out for Tool, please? Because Tool rocks, man. All right, here's Barry's answer to popping this lock. Barry at Tool. Cut the toilet paper roll, get a little piece of it, cut it out of the corner, wrap it into a little cylinder, and
stick it in the lock. You twist it a little bit. And open.
Toilet paper. Mm-hmm. Tool rocks. All right, how about breaking this one? Beer can, maybe it's still like a shim thing though, right? All right, pen and paper, you're getting close. How about this? Possibly. All right, most of you have seen this. I'm not like preaching to the choir, but it's relatively simple. A lot of these locks, you put a little bit of tension on it. You pull it until it starts to catch, and you move it back and forth to try to find sticking points. Like this one sticks at 1 and 2, which makes the point in the center 1.5. You do this all the way around the lock. Here's a sticking point at 7.5 and 8.5. Sticking point in the middle is an 8. So you take these numbers, you run them down. Here they are on the right-hand side of this table. You write them all the way down across the entire lock, and you get these numbers. Get rid of every number that's not a whole number, because they're decoys. Get rid of every number that doesn't end in the same number, in this case 8. You're left with one number. This is the last digit of the lock. Right? A little mod 4, you get down to 100 or less combinations on the next two digits, or the first two digits. Estimated time for breaking this lock, less than 3 minutes. With your fingers. All right? There you go. Now, the push button lock. My favorite. It's just a design flaw, you know? A lock where you have to push buttons in front of other people. All right, so I decided this is just too easy. So I'm gonna find a lock in a place that's a little bit sketchy, right? Where I could probably get busted lots of different ways, and I'll see if I can get the combination anyway. So I went to the airport, sat by the pilot's pre-flight door, and waited. All right, ready? See if you can catch it. Design flaw. So put the camera around my back. Here's a little shot of his butt. Here's me shoulder surfing the pilot. And this is what they call the money shot. This is the shoulder surfing plus the badge all in one picture. A problem. So the answer is to update your policies. Never allow any of this into any building that you work for. All right, and here's one for an added bonus. You want to see how to break into a long haul fiber cabinet? It's one motion, it's really easy. You want to see? All right. This is it. Ready? See, I turned my head. That's the motion. I'll do it again. See? I'm walking down the sidewalk. I do the motion, and bing. I mean, it's like the Jedi wave, just a heck of a lot cooler. I mean, there's even, like, instructions for how to, like, rewire it. Thought this was great. All right, so let's talk a little bit more about physical security. This was a show on the Discovery Channel called Unsolved History of the Ninjas. You can see why I was hooked. All right, so the premise of the show was, let's take a modern security force like the Navy SEALs, and let's compare their tactics to a single unarmed ninja. I kid you not, right? So the SEAL team is like, okay, led by this guy, all right? And the premise was that you take the building and he can put the hostage anywhere in the building that he wants. Him and another guy have to guard the hostage. If the attack team takes the hostage's hat off, hostage is dead, right? So they put him in the bathroom where there's no windows. They hunker him down. They bring in the Navy SEALs, who I think it's ironic that they dress like ninjas, complete with automatic weapons and their tree man. So they've got like a team of six and snipers and weapons and all that, and this is basically what they do.
The SEALs made short work of the guards using surprise and overwhelming firepower to get to their target. But how would a ninja fare? Would he be able to get past the guards?
Silly SEALs. All right, so then they bring out a ninja. Now, anybody that's in Bujinkan, don't yell at me. I'm fully aware that this guy was thrown out of Bujinkan and that technically there's like some strife between him and Hatsumi Sensei, so, you know, but we'll just go and call him a ninja because he's got skills, right? He was taught by the Grandmaster and so he's got credibility. He's unarmed. He has to do the same exact thing. Now, I was a little disappointed, right? I'm thinking swords and flash bombs and shurikens and like gore everywhere. Right, so, but then they took away the swords and the shurikens and everything, and I'm like, okay, well, there's still gonna be gore everywhere. All right, but here's what he did.
It took Hayes over 4 hours to wear down the guards and successfully reach the target.
What I enjoyed about this assigned mission was it was an opportunity to really show people how the ninja would operate. By going in without any overt weapons actually allowed me to move right into the middle of all that danger.
Is it okay if I just get that one spray, right there?
I got duped by him. I mean, it was believable that he was the maintenance guy. I screwed up.
So the ninja puts on a hat, gets a ladder, and a can of compressed air. So he goes from ninja to old guy in hat. Now, I'm not putting down the Navy SEALs by any means, but, you know, it does make you wonder. Old guy in hat versus team of Navy SEALs. I think it was a little lopsided. All right, so moving right along, though, this is like one guy, right? Now, if you have a team of ninjas, you could get lots of people into the building. It only makes sense. Most of us do not have a team of ninjas. Most of us. Right? So I thought to myself, there's got to be a better way to get lots of people into a building, right? Lots of people into a building all at one time. Any ideas? No? Oh, okay. No. All right, here it is. You ready? Historical documentation.
Cadeau, what?
A present.
Oh, un cadeau.
Oui, oui.
Allons-y.
What?
Let's go.
Oh.
What happens now?
Well, now, Lancelot, Galahad, and I wait until nightfall and then leap out of the rabbit, taking the French by surprise. Not only by surprise, but totally unarmed.
Who leaps out?
Lancelot, Galahad, and I leap out of the rabbit and... Look, if we built this large wooden badger...
So it was a great idea, right? But nothing like this could ever possibly happen in the real world, right?
Can we just take the charge in Austin?
Can we just leave it here overnight?
You're going to pick up tomorrow morning again, are you?
Yeah, pick it up tomorrow morning.
Right, your left-hand side up the next one.
Okay, mate.
Hi.
Don't know what shit like this is coming in. Exciting. Who's
the fucking great big football.
Where's the history department?
Quadrangle.
Yeah.
Thanks, mate. Right.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
Consul General, we just want to leave it here for the night. Hello? We can't leave this here. We just got this Trojan horse. Can we leave it here for the night?
Inside.
What do you mean? I'm sure there's no one inside. Why would there be anyone inside? Can we just leave it here at the barracks for the night? I had no idea he was in there. I had no idea.
Excuse me.
Hey. Wait.
So that was the Australian Army. Any Australians here? Yeah, don't raise your hand right now. The problem is, this isn't just Australia. It seems that this exact thing has happened to the U.S. government as well. All right. Let me explain it to you. I'm driving along and I see this truck. This is the Trojan Horse Trucking Company. Pretty obvious, right? You'll never guess what they're carrying. The Trojan Horse Trucking Company is a contractor for the U.S. government mail service. So the Trojan Horse Trucking Company is carrying the U.S. mail. The funny thing, though, is I noticed that this little truck, the truck next to it, Nationwide Express, always traveled with it, which is cool because it's monitored by V-chip technology. Probably why we could never hack it or whatever. All right, so the moral of the story is everything lost? The answer is absolutely yes, you're all screwed. That's it, that's what I've got. Don't forget to check out ihackcharities.org. Thanks for having me.